But hurry, our new spring colors are on sale for this week only at Sears retail stores in Canada, where you get your money's worth and more.
Good morning. I've got to get something off my chest off the top this morning and tell you, first of all, that the Liberal leader, the short-time Prime Minister, John Turner, I suspect was absolutely shattered on this program yesterday by the response of telephone callers to his attacks on Elmer McKay and Crosby, because Turner was out of touch a long while. And I don't think he yet realizes how strong and deep the hostility is to the Liberal Party. And when the Liberals attack anyone for dereliction of duty or lack of public morality, of course, everyone, properly too, came out of the woodwork yesterday and said, hey, what about Francis Fox? What about Bryce McKissy? What about the fact that you will not, to this day, release the letters you exchanged with Trudeau on the patronage appointments? Now, I personally don't mind what you say to John Turner, but myself, I was a little bit, shall I say, perplexed by the lack of any appreciation of the principles involved in the current crisis in the federal government, because this is the kind of issue that sets the tone of public morality in this country. And before I start, let me tell you how the system is supposed to work. When an elected public official faces serious allegations, the only right and honorable thing to do, as Coates did, is quit or at least say, I am under a severe cloud. Please put me on the sidelines until I am totally cleared or something else happens. Now, it's this one. I've watched Hatfield's 11-minute statement now 3 or 4 times, and it can best be described as an incomplete, self-serving statement which does not answer many of the major questions which have been raised. And first of all, and here I am being one of the ghouls or the vultures of the media, seeking cheap sensation, of course. First of all, let's look from Mr. Hatfield's own lips at his lifestyle as Premier of the province.
Those who know me will confirm I am extremely gregarious. I meet and talk to people on the streets, in the markets, in the shops, in the restaurants, and in the bars. I invite them to my house. I go to their house. The door to my house is usually unlocked and frequently open. That is my way. I admit I am unconventional.
If that is his way and his door is open and people pop in to see him, or he meets them in bars or restaurants or the streets or the markets, he can almost expect to get into trouble, because as he stated yesterday, he's not aware of the truthfulness of the people. But I suggest to you this morning that Mr. Hatfield himself made a very good case yesterday, despite his absolute denials of any form of guilt whatsoever. He made a very good case for an instant Royal Commission of Inquiry. And why do I make that case? I want you to listen to this extract from his statement yesterday.
I have been found innocent in a fair trial of the only charge brought against me. To those who sought to profit by their wickedness, they should know they have failed.
To those who sought to profit from their wickedness, they should know they have failed. Here is the Premier of New Brunswick telling us that there is a major and serious conspiracy by these people who seek to profit from their wickedness to frame him and destroy his career. But what does he tell us yesterday? He tells us that sure, he can sue, but he's not going to sue unless he absolutely has to. Now, in that statement yesterday, and one must accept his denials on the face of it, was there any mention of the secret meeting on neutral ground between Premier Hatfield and the Solicitor General Elmer McKay? No, there was not any explanation. Why was there not an explanation? What happened at that meeting? If I'm charged today, I'm going to phone up Elmer McKay and say, Elmer, I want to meet you on neutral ground in a suite at the whatever hotel in Ottawa, and I want you to know that I strongly resent being investigated by the RCMP, and what right have you got to investigate me just because somebody suggests I may have committed a crime? And then there is no mention whatsoever of these people whom he met somewhere and whom he took to Montreal and why he took them to Montreal. There is one thing I've got to say in his favor, and a number of people are confused in this. There is nothing wrong with Crosby's people in the Justice Department laying the information or deciding the form of the charge. What a number of people have forgotten is that while provincial attorneys general control the administration of justice in all normal charges, the federal government, Liberal and now Tory, has always retained the right of the federal legal system to lay all narcotics charges. So remember that. Perhaps some of those who have sought to profit from the wickedness too, they may be these people he met in bars who are not necessarily truthful. They may be RCMP officers who have leaked this damaging, unfair, slanderous information, if such, about Hatfield, and they may be, of course, those people who were not named by Mr. Hatfield who received the unmarked brown envelope with these two witnesses' statements. So therefore, it's not just the RCMP, it's not just the people he met and took to his home where the door is apparently always unlocked in his gregarious manner, but it's also specific members of the media. Now, surely Mr. Hatfield wants to catch and punish these people who sought to profit from their wickedness. If he doesn't sue, if there is no inquiry, we shall never know. And the cloud will be left there very much to the damage to overall public political morality in this country. Well, that's that. We're going to have Kaplan here on Friday morning. We'll have a batch with Kaplan. And I'll remind him at the very top of the program that he was part of the government that had Francis Fox in it and all the other liberal problems of these years. But don't let party labels fool you. There is an important public principle for the country and non-political people, regardless of their affiliations. Now, back to old clothes and porridge in Vancouver Island. I have here two men. I have the mayor of North Cowichan, Graham Bruce, and Don McMullen, chairman of an advisory council on silviculture, because they have a bold plan, a strategy for survival through silviculture for the Vancouver Island, which is very hard hit and whose future in the forestry industry don't look all that good at the moment. And then at the end of the program, or nearer to the end of the program, we're going to have Alderman Gordon Campbell, who apparently rubs Harcourt, the mayor of Vancouver, very much the wrong way. And I think that's good, because Mike is far too smug these days, especially after he backed York to get the seat on the council. So we're going to have Alderman Gordon Campbell to tell us what's wrong with Harcourt and the Vancouver City Council. But off the top, strategy for survival on Vancouver Island after the break. We're going to talk about a $22 million a year forest investment proposal for Vancouver Island that will create 1,200 jobs. That's what they tell me. Here is Graham Bruce, mayor of North Cowichan, and here is Don McMullen, a forester, chairman of this advisory council on silviculture, and you're going to tell me, Graham, off the top, what you're trying to do to lift Vancouver Island out of its present slough of depression.
Well, Jack, what we've done, we have put together a proposal for Vancouver Island, which we feel definitely, obviously, will have impact on the island, but it is a plank in the revitalization of the economy for Vancouver Island that can be used as a model for all of British Columbia and for, in fact, across this country of Canada. Now, what we've done, because of the experience we've had in North Cowichan is a community that is unique and it owns one of its own forests, and this is not something that's common throughout the country. We embarked in 1979-1980 on an intensive forest management program. Because of the recession that we found ourselves in, the municipality was able to take advantage of the Canada Works and EBAP programs that came along and able to employ over 1,000 different individuals in a community that was hard hit with unemployment problems.
This is in your own forest?
This is in our own forest.
I didn't know you had your own forest.
Oh, we do. We're right next to the district of Nottingham, Sherwood Forest, and I'm not Robin Hood, but I like to pretend I am from time to time. But what we were able to do was to not only put that number of people back to work, but bring into our economy some $4 million, which has had a vital effect on the community of Cowichan and Duncan and surrounding area. Because of that success, and because of the fact that we had considerable number of people that were prepared to go to work and wanted to work, we took it upon ourselves through the assistance of our Forest Advisory Committee, this is North Cowichan's Forest Advisory Committee, which Don McMullen is the chairman, to take a bold step and look at Vancouver Island as a unit to see what could be done on Vancouver Island in an effort to garden this crop and to employ a considerable number of people.
Has nobody else been doing this kind of thing before?
No, it's been done before, but not to the same intensity and not with the same ring that we're bringing to it.
All right, now stop there for a moment. It's not just North Cowichan. Who backs your plan? We'll get into the details later, but who backs the plan?
All the communities of Vancouver Island. What we did after presenting our proposal, or putting it together, was we had a meeting of the mayors of Vancouver Island, and we took them up into the bush on a look and see, a show and tell. We had raindrops as big as golf balls, and for 3 hours, they climbed the hills of the forests of North Cowichan, in and out, to understand what we were actually talking about, how it is that the types of jobs we were proposing could actually create real wealth for the country. How simple is it? How hard is it to sell a simple idea?
We'll talk about money later. Now, you're a forester.
Right.
And you're the chairman of this advisory council on silviculture.
Yes.
I'm going to ask you a stupid question deliberately. This is more talk about reforestation.
This is not reforestation, Jack, and that's one of the main problems we have. What we're talking about here is once you've done the reforestation, what do you do? Do you walk away? Do you throw the seed in the ground? Like if you're going to garden carrots, for instance, do you throw that seed in the ground and hope to come back in August and have a crop of carrots? You're not going to get it. You're going to get weeds there. You're going to get great big holes there. You're going to get sludge there. When you think about it, and the experience the North Cowichan has had, we took a garbage-type stand, and it's a Cinderella story. We took a garbage-type stand, we went in, we actually farmed that forest, and now it's beautiful. There's magic in that forest. And if we could get you out there with your cameras into that forest, we could show you that magic. And what we're trying to do now is say, if we're so successful on a small piece of land, and it's only 5,000 hectares with North Cowichan.
10,000 acres?
12,000.
12,000 acres.
Close. Uh-huh. We can do that for all of Vancouver Island, and if we're successful on Vancouver Island, we think we can take that right across the province of British Columbia and right across Canada.
How long before you get any... First of all, it's going to have to be a subsidized operation.
No, it's not subsidized. This is an investment proposal. This is as good a proposal as Victoria or Ottawa have ever had presented to them. It's as good as De Havilland. It's as good as Canadair, Tumbler Ridge, Expo. It's a business investment proposal.
I'm with you, but let's be practical. 25,000 guys in the woods and the sawmills are out of work right now. Many companies are teetering on the edge of disaster. Some have already gone over the brink. You're not going to get the money from logging companies, are you?
No, we're not.
Where are you going to get it?
We are already in this country, and on Vancouver Island alone, expending in 1 year $250 million in UIC payments. Now, the people today that are on UIC are not sitting there wanting that UIC payment. They want a job. They want to produce. They want to be part of this country. And this gives them that opportunity to be able to take that paycheck and to be able to go to work and create real wealth for the country. This is a business investment proposal.
You're saying take the UIC money or whatever, put people back to work at wages, union wages, of course.
We are saying that the money is available. The money is within reach. It's political will. What it comes down to is the general public of Vancouver Island, British Columbia, and Canada basically understanding the importance of the forest industry to the economy of this province and to the economy of this country.
Why do we have to leave it to North Cowichan to discover this?
You're not leaving it to North Cowichan. You now have the entire community of Vancouver Island, and by the time we're finished, we're going to have the entire community of British Columbia.
Is this not a condemnation of forest management in British Columbia?
No, because the landowner, which is the public, has not had an opportunity to really understand the investment potential. And the investment potential is fantastic. It's a 6%, Jack. It's a 6% real return on investment. There was a study done a couple years ago in the United States which indicated for all of the industries in the United States, the real rate of return on all industry was in the 3-4% range. This is 6% guaranteed. And we've got to get that message across to the public so they can start farming their forests.
All right. Let's take a break then. I'll come back with, and I want to recap some of this after the break. Graham Bruce is mayor of North Cowichan. Don McMullen is the chairman of this advisory council on silviculture, and they have an intriguing proposition. How many thousands of hectares of neglected forest land, publicly owned, could be handled in the way you've done the North Cowichan forest?
On Vancouver Island, we estimate there's 55,000 hectares that should be treated per year, year after year after year. So if it is year after year, these are permanent jobs. And for a $22 million investment per year, the governments are going to reap around $79 million in direct revenue, but the actual value of the stand at the time of harvest in about 45 years is going to be worth $655 million.
What kind of trees would you concentrate on? What kind of lumber? What kind of Douglas fir?
No, well, whatever species is there, because Vancouver Island has a lot of hemlock and balsam cedar on the west coast, a lot of Douglas fir and hemlock on the east coast.
What I want to know is, if you got the $22 million, we'll talk about that in a minute, what's done with that $22 million? What do you actually do in silviculture that's not reforestation? You're not going to stick trees in with a gun.
No, that's right. And the proposal addressed specifically those phases of silviculture that will really generate a real return in terms of volume production and value production. So we said brushing and weeding, which is like weeding your garden, conifer release, which is like weeding after the fact when you get maybe alder coming in over top of your crop trees, and the most important is juvenile spacing, like when you have a carrot patch, thinning it out so you get great big fat carrots. And big fat carrots you can sell on the market. Big fat trees you can sell on the market, and you can make very valuable products.
We don't do much in the way of silviculture at all in the forests in BC at the moment, I gather.
We do some. But the point is that it has to be understood, and through this whole exercise we've had, and when we talk to the general public and when we talk to the media and individuals like yourself, it comes back to reforestation. It's a reforestation
proposal.
It's a garden. This is a garden. And it requires more than just planting the crop.
In other words,
it requires some tender loving care.
If the Chinese had these trees, they would, with so many bodies that they have, they would do the weeding, the brush cutting, the conifer removal, the spacing, the removal of the alders and all the scrub stuff you don't want on a steady basis. How much would that increase the volume per hectare or whatever?
It depends on how good the site is, but you can take it from at least doubling it on some sites to maybe 3 or 4 times on the very best sites. But when you talk about, you know, should we do it or shouldn't we do it, we compete in world markets, and we compete against the Swedes and the Finns for a lot of the Atlantic seaboard and certainly the European markets. And without exception, all the major companies in Europe and all the major companies in New Zealand and all the major companies in the United States and the governments in Europe carry out juvenile spacing. They must carry out juvenile spacing if they're going to increase the value of the crop. And they do the brushing and weeding, and they do the conifer.
We've had so much available lumber in the coast of the Vancouver Island that we've just taken the trees and stuck in some new ones now and again.
We're living on the legacy of the virgin old growth forest. And as long as we have that, there isn't enough pressure or enough understanding to realize that we've got to farm the second growth crop. And that's what we're talking about.
Now, this would be for all unemployed people in the woods. And how many would get $22 million in 1 year employ on Vancouver Island?
Over 1,100 people.
At reasonable rates of pay?
At reasonable rates of pay.
The other Cinderella story, Jack, is when you talk to these people who have worked on North Cowichan, the pride in what they've achieved out there is just incredible. You've taken a person who's been downtrodden, has been out of work, maybe never had a job, and he's gone out there and he can see what he's done. He can actually physically see by looking back.
What about North Cowichan? How did you finance this in North Cowichan for your own program?
North Cowichan was no different than any other forest in this country. We had been doing very well, just taking the revenue from the forest. In fact, 79 and 80 combined, we had done over $500,000 in stumpage. Now, we own the forest outright, so that's money to ourselves. And like any government, we as a group felt pretty good with that extra revenue. And if we needed a new fire truck for one of our four departments, or we needed to pave a new road or something along that line, we could go ahead and do that without having to raise taxes. And of course, it's the same aspect of things with the general public, in that which would they rather have, the new road, the new fire truck, the community hall, or to put the money back in the forest?
And they'd rather have the new road, the new truck, the new hall.
That's right, and it's an education thing. This is what it's come down to. Now, our community understands that now. It's coming around. But you know, Jack, I'm a perfect example of the ignorance in this country. I've lived in that community, born and raised all my life, own a family grocery operation, depended upon that forest industry, but never really understood the basic meaning of what forestry, what it means to our economy, not only locally, but to the province and to this country. And all the time when we talk about forestry in British Columbia, we just center on the aspect of forestry in British Columbia. But it's not. It's the number one industry. It's the major industry in this country, across this country. It's the number one employer across this country.
All right, $22 million. Who spends the $22 million?
Who spends the $22 million?
What agency will spend and allocate the jobs on the 55,000 hectares he's talking about doing each year?
What we have done in our proposal here with the mayors and the approaches we've made to the federal and provincial government is that there are obviously some obstacles and hurdles that we have to jump through, such as the question you've given us today. Now, we suggested that an advisory committee be established to weed out the little problems and come up with those answers. Now, we would see that it would be a couple of federal representatives and a couple of provincial representatives and a couple of mayors just to keep the thing moving along.
We could do it with this for all of British Columbia.
Most definitely we could. And it can be delivered. There are small industries out there right now that can do this type of work that can employ these people.
Who would benefit most from it? Surely not the big lumber companies.
No, the landowners. The landowners are the public. If you want to buy fire trucks in the year 2020, you better start farming your forest now, because it's the only renewable resource
we've got.
I
thought the whole pie in Vancouver Island had been sliced up and given away to the big boys years ago.
Sure, and they take a small slice of the profits in the year 2020, but the major slice, by far the major slice...
The stumpage profits, the royalties.
Stumpage is peanuts. It's income tax, corporate income tax, personal income tax. That's what drives this country. That's what pays for our schools, our hospitals, and our roads.
So you're looking for... who have you seen?
We've been back to Ottawa. We met with Gerald Marathieu.
Who's he?
The federal minister of forests.
Never heard of him, never seen him.
Well,
we have a federal minister of forests.
You better get him out here then and have a chat with him.
He doesn't know where Vancouver is.
Yes, he does. We've explained
to
him.
How do you spell his name?
Maybe he doesn't know where Vancouver is, but he knows where Vancouver Island is, because we've had him out there and we've had him through our forest.
Marathieu. Is he bright?
Yes, he is.
Is he a Tory?
Yes, he is.
Does that go together? Never mind. Who else have you seen?
We saw a special assistant.
And Matthew said, yes, I'll give you the money.
No, he didn't.
No,
you know, I mean, that's ridiculous to walk into someone's office for a multi-million-dollar investment proposal and say, hey, here's a great proposal, it's on paper, now give us a check for $22.5 million. This is a business investment proposal. We are trying to explain to them how they can invest the money of this country and give a good return.
Matthew, whatever his name is, he's sympathetic.
He's energetic.
What about our dynamic Minister of Forests here, Mr. Waterland?
Yes, we had a good hearing with him. 15 mayors from Vancouver Island, we all got together. We had a good go with that, and Mr. Waterland was 100% behind us. He, too, would put a representative on this committee, and he got us before the Cabinet Committee for Economic Development.
Anybody else?
Yes, we're also looking for a representative from the Ministry of Employment and Immigration, Flora McDonald's office. And we hope to have that shortly. We hope to be able to see her personally. And we also are looking for a representative, and which seems to be forthcoming, from the Ministry of Labor, Bob McClellan's office. Now, to back up the fact that we have a business investment proposal, we took it another step. We asked the chief executive officers of the major lumber companies in this province to a meeting in North Cowichan to explain our proposal, to show them firsthand what we're doing, and to show that this wasn't a program of jobs for the sake of jobs, but was a solid business investment proposal that had an economic return and had a tremendous social return to this province.
They agree. They understand the 6% return on investment. The Economic Development Committee, I believe, now understands that this is one hell of an opportunity.
When do you get a decision? When do you get a decision?
We're working towards that. We're looking to get that advisory committee together to go through the different steps, the questions, how shall it be delivered? What type of percentage share should it be between the federal and provincial governments? What type of area are you going to start with? Hopefully, our target date, as the mayors of Vancouver Island, our target date is the 1st of April. That's ambitious, it's aggressive, but there's no reason why it can't be done.
You want to talk about this on the air from Vancouver Island or anywhere else? We have Graham Bruce, the mayor of North Cowichan, and Don McMullen, forester and chairman of the advisory council, after the break. Well, even I'm enthusiastic. How many jobs could this create across the country now?
Probably 500,000, Jack.
I don't pull my leg.
I wouldn't pull your
leg. That's conservative, Jack. That's a conservative estimate of real wealth-producing
jobs. You mean if somebody funded this, federal, provincial, surely the big TFL holders should also fund part of it.
If you could give them some guarantee of return on investment, I'm sure they would. But if you're only a tenant, which is what they are, on the public land base, then it's hard to ask them to kick up a lot of money.
So we're looking for federal, provincial money.
Yes, we are. We're looking for federal investment dollars and provincial investment dollars on behalf of the people of this country in the resource that is theirs.
How much would you need to create your 500,000 jobs?
Oh, considerably more money. I don't have that particular figure. But what we are saying is that this is a plank for economic recovery, not only in British Columbia, but for Canada. Well, a major plank.
Isn't Bennett meeting with
First Ministers?
Today?
Yes.
And I bet he only talks about reforestation. Does he know about this?
We have presented to the economic committee of cabinet.
Okay. Yes. Well, they should know.
And Waterloo will be there.
Oh yes. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Jack.
Morning.
I sit here totally awestruck and flabbergasted. For the first time in years, I see people on your show, Jack, that are talking about taking care of the forest rather than cutting trees down like there's no tomorrow and putting people to work, hopefully the ones who are on welfare, and return to them a little bit of the dignity as human beings. Before I hang up and get your answer, there's one thing I'd like to ask you. What do you think about this idiotic plan to log Mears Island, cutting down trees that have taken thousands of years to grow in just a couple of seconds of total irresponsibility? I'll hang up and hear what you guys have to say. All the power to you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mears Island is something that we ourselves are not able to address in the context that you're talking about. You know, the whole situation when it comes to forestry, to Jack, there have been the historical positions of the federal government, the provincial government, labor, industry, environment, and the fight goes on. Those types of problems will be around for many years to come. And whether you're in favor of logging Mears Island or you're opposed to logging Mears Island is immaterial right at this point in time in what our program. We've got to keep this thing positive and straightforward.
And if Mears Island was unique, it'd be worthwhile preserving. But the West Coast Trail, the Pacific Rim Park, already protects thousands of hectares of stands identical to that. So there's no call for it.
But the main thrust has got to be in this program. We can shoot it down tomorrow. We can find enough obstacles. We can find enough historical positions taken by all groups in society to forget about it. But the one thing to remember, Jack, is I've got a brother-in-law with four kids and a wife, and he hasn't got a job, and he needs a job, and now he knows that there's a way that he can have that job and create real wealth.
Go ahead from Kamloops.
Yes, I just have one statement and one question. I was wondering if they were going to do this on the same lines as the immigration's, you know, unemployment works program now going on, and how much, if it's not, how much would the pay scale be, you know, in the plan that you have? I'll hang up and let you answer.
Basically, our pay scale is on that basis. Now, what we've done is taking the experience in North Cowichan and finding and showing how successful it is. We have not altered the actual pay scale or the delivery of that program.
This now, is the EBAP pay scale.
This is the EBAP Canada Works pay scale. Mm-hmm. However, that is a question that would be addressed by the advisory committee. And the thing that we're trying to put across in this whole program is people come back to say, okay, is it going to be EBAP? Is it going to be Canada Works? Enough is enough. Enough is enough. If you can put 1,000 people back to work, put them back to work and put them back to work permanently, not on a 4-month turnaround. We've had people on our program that have been with us for 2 years, but they've been with us on a 4-month turnaround. You haven't put those people back into the economy. You haven't given them the confidence to go and buy a house or a new car.
You're not doing permanent employment on your thing.
No, we're tied within the Canada Works framework.
You say make it permanent jobs instead of
EBAP. Make a permanent job.
Go ahead, please, from Seashell.
Congratulations, Mayor Bruce Graham. I would just like to say that a couple of weeks ago, the BC TV News Hour had a segment of the new reality, and they covered tariffs and they were stating that 36,000 hectares were bare, and my husband stated that it's about time that they put these people back to work doing an area such as this reforestation, and congratulations on all the power to you, and I hope that you succeed.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
That's you. Speak up.
Yes. Did you watch Looting a Legacy on the Journal, October 29th,
1984? No.
They cover the same subject these men are doing, and I hope these guys succeed because that's exactly what should be done with these forests. I'd like to see them go half a step further in stopping the logging companies from smashing down the 5, 10, 15, 20-year-old lumber that they do smash down. It still should be there and still should be farmed from that point. Not smashed down.
Let's ask a forester about that.
Well, that I think what he's talking about is juvenile spacing. And if you want to get a big tree, a fat tree, and a tree that's worth value, you have to go in there and you have to space out the stand.
You and
do it in your character.
If you don't space out the stand, you've got to smash down the younger ones.
You're growing wheat. And Jack, we can't sell wheat on world markets.
Wheat. Wheat.
It's really important when we get to forestry, Jack. There is so many misconceptions. There is so much ignorance about that industry. And I'm a prime example. I'm the first to say. And it is important that the community as a whole, Vancouver Island, British Columbia, and this country, understands what forestry is all about. I mean, I'm excited about it because it's been explained to me.
You're terrific. Go ahead, please. Where are you?
Hello.
That's you.
Yeah. I'd like to say that I'm an ex-logger. I've planted trees. I've worked both coasts. And I've seen what happens with planting trees. And, you know, so many die on the side of the mountain without being looked after later. I've planted the same areas 3 times in a row. And I'd just like to say that about New Zealand, fantastic forest management down there. I was there 4 years ago, and the whole, both islands, north and south, it's just miles and miles and miles of beautifully spaced trees ready for market.
Goodbye. Is reforestation sometimes wasted? Do you sometimes have to
time if you don't follow up, Jack, and that's what we're talking about in this whole program. If the reforestation is done, as the caller says, you have to go back and you have to weed the trees.
Why
are
the New Zealanders so good at it?
Because they have the whole concept in mind. They know where they're going. They know that they have to farm their forest. And in New Zealand, that's what they are. They are forest farms.
The other thing that must be understood from the public perception, Jack, and this is one thing that was very graphically expressed with the mayors in Vancouver Island. We took them into this area that was barren. There was weed. There was snow. It looked terrible. It looked like we had logged it and raped it and walked away from it. But what we did in our little presentation, after, as we were talking, we started scraping away a little bit of the bush and a little bit of the snow and the weed. And what did we have in front of us in this whole area? A whole pile of little seedlings that were planted and coming up. And it was amazing how many people had said, you know, we've driven by areas on Vancouver Island that we thought had been left, that people had raped, they'd taken the trees and gone from. But in fact, they had been replanted. People didn't understand the fact that that little tree needs a little bit more help than just being plugged into the ground.
More with Mayor Bruce and Don McMullen after the break. Couple of men with what looks like a practical vision. Would you believe it? Start with $22 million in Vancouver Island, put 1,100 people back to permanent work, spread it across the country. Could be 500,000 jobs. Even reforestation could produce an awful lot of jobs too, couldn't it?
Yes, it could.
Can reforestation and silviculture work hand in hand? It must.
It's all part of the same thing. You know, reforestation is a phase of silviculture, Jack.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead,
but
please.
People forget about the rest of it.
Let's call it tending the garden.
Let's call it farming the forest.
Farming the forest. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, would this be strictly for export, or would it be create more jobs by selling it to the export market as finished product?
It creates a phenomenal number of jobs down the road. On our little proposal for Vancouver Island, we're looking at some 38,000 new jobs at the end of the 45-year cycle. Now, what you then have is a situation of a good, healthy crop. You can get into good remanufacturing, you get into good lumber processing. You know, we have the world by the tail when it comes to the forest industry, except we as a country haven't woken up to that fact.
But the figures are, is that if you have one job in logging, you create around four jobs in the manufacturing sector, but you also create around six or seven jobs indirectly in the servicing sector, in the transportation sector. So those are jobs within British Columbia.
Where it would go in the world markets would depend entirely on the state of the trade at the time, wouldn't it?
And the key thing with juvenile spacing is, if you can put a quality piece on the market at a low cost, then we will be able to compete in the markets. If we don't do it, we will not compete in the year 2020.
Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
I have a two-part question. One, you say that this is all public land. Is the public allowed to take part in any way, shape, or form, like investments from the public? And secondly, the second question is that this silviculture, this process of silviculture, how long does the public have to wait before they get the results? Before we actually see, in terms of investments, the returns on our investments.
Explain the return on the investment again. Obviously, you're not asking the public to buy shares because this is TFL land, much of it, some of it public, all in the public domain, but it's not something you want to sell stock in.
90% of the forest land is public, but selling stock is not a bad idea, Jack, if you're prepared to wait
45 years.
Well, maybe not even 45 years, because you're putting 1,100 people back to work in Vancouver Island right now, which reduces your UIC costs, which means frees up money for other industry. So maybe you can work into some return on investments earlier in the game rather than wait for 45 years. And every year you do it, maybe you can build up a return on investment. So I like that idea.
There are some exciting proposals we've had from people, and this is what's been interesting in this two-month venture so far, is the calls we're getting from people, the ideas. One chap phoned me the other day and suggested the idea of a lotto, a tree lotto. Another suggested that we sell tree bonds. The point is whether those ideas are good or not is immaterial. The fact is that people can see it. They can see the magic in this, and they want to participate.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah. I've been a logger also, and for the past 25 years there, I've wondered at all these miles and miles of stripped land, and I think they've got a good idea to replant these stripped land areas. But why not spend some of this time lobbying the government and having a simple law put into effect or a clause on the tree farm licenses in the fact that any company farming an area must replant that area as soon as they've logged it out. What's wrong with that?
Well, I would like to correct that statement, because the tree farm licenses are acknowledged nationally and certainly internationally as having the best forestry in Canada, and the status of reforestation on these lands is excellent, and there's no question about that.
Well, but just a minute, I want to get that clear though. We're talking right now about Crown land, inside and outside TFLs.
Yes. If you're talking about the portions outside, and particularly on the mainland of this province, we do not have enough seedlings for that reforestation to take place. On Vancouver Island, we have a success story in reforestation. There is almost no NSR on Vancouver Island.
NSR?
Not sufficiently restocked lands.
Not sufficiently restocked lands. But this silviculture industry would work on both Crown lands and TFL lands.
Yes.
In other words, you've got to get... Are you telling me that the big companies, the TFLs, don't do enough silviculture at the moment?
They are not funded to the extent to permit them to do enough silviculture, because the funding must come from the government, because government is the landowner on behalf of the public. And so what the caller really should be saying is that we must lobby the public to generate funds into silviculture.
Can we come back to the historical positions? We come back to big company and small operator and big union and the fact that the federal government should be doing more, or the provincial government should be doing more. We come back to all these historic positions all the time. rather than getting on with what has to be done. If you know, if you go to the industry itself, you can hear the professional foresters say one thing. In fact, you can see an article written by a professional forester in one of the newspapers, and the next day you'll find another professional forester that's contradicting what that guy said. Now we got to get past that. This is our resource. This is your resource and my resource. We got to invest in that resource.
Go ahead, please. Hello. Where is he? Go ahead, please.
Yes, I would like to ask your guests how they feel about the recent statement by the government that they're no longer in a position to fund Section 88 grants which affect silviculture in this province for the large companies. And this is where the large companies derive their money to reforest the lands that they have logged, which really in a sense is a statement to the government. The Forest Service in this province is bankrupt. They haven't made any money, so therefore they can't pay out to the companies the money which is owing to them for Section 88 silviculture. How, in effect, does this affect their project and their proposed plans? Because it's all very well saying the public has got to put money in, but the public is the Forest Service in this province. Where are we going to get the funds to do it?
I think she said something. Section 88, is that the one by which the forest companies recover the
funds that they expend on reforestation?
And
roads, that's right. So both of it comes out of the same pot.
Well, I know the big companies have been complaining that the government is not kicking in with the Section 88 money. It's very slow on it, making it very difficult for the big companies.
Yes, and particularly in the interior. It's not bad on the coast, because on the coast we generate higher value in the volume we log. But in the interior, there's companies that have 4 or 5 years of accounts owing them.
I know.
Jack, let's come back to the fire trucks. Where do you want it? Do you want a new fire truck? Do you want a new road? Do you want a new school? Do you want a new hospital? Or do you want to take the money and put it back into the forest?
No. That's not the point she's making with respect, Mayor Bruce. Well, she's saying that the government of Victoria has deliberately adopted a foot-dragging policy on return of revenues to forest industry because they say they're pretty close to up against the wall.
Unless
they also correct Section 88 deficiencies. Am I right, caller?
Correct.
The program might become a bit of a sham. In other words, you've got to get Waterland convinced, with Bennett convinced, that a priority of expenditures is also on paying the Section 88 money to the companies so they can carry out their responsibilities.
So what we need, Jack, is 500 letters a day being dumped on Premier Bennett's desk from the citizens, the landowners of this province.
That's the challenge.
That will generate the funds. That will direct the money into the Forest Service.
Jack, the challenge is not the politicians in this case. The challenge is not the politicians. It's the people of this country to understand the importance of the forest industry. To understand if they want that school and they want that hospital, the only way they're going to have it in this country is by a strong, healthy forest industry.
I'm with you all the way. I think you've got a terrific plan. I think it's capable of fruition. But that woman's plan is very good. You must convince Premier Bennett that money is available, that a priority for monies is to make the forest industry healthy on Section 88, take partners with the federal government and maybe some of the companies, and get the people back to work in April.
That's right. So we need everybody, as Don said, everybody in the province, everybody across this country, writing provincially and federally, to say, hey, our number one pillar in the economy of this country is forestry. Let's do something about it. We shouldn't have a junior federal minister of forests. It should be a senior minister of forests in the federal government. It should be right up there by the Minister of Finance. That's how important it is to this country.
And what we need is for your caller to take a sheet around her block, get all her neighbors' signatures, demanding money be reinvested in the forests.
Reinvest the money in BC's forests.
I would like to make a further point the fact that in doing this, the government is no longer committed to silviculture, and the federal government committed, I believe, my figure may be wrong, but I thought it was $330 million federally to silviculture, providing that that our provincial government made.
They are discussing that at the moment, and something may come out of it in the First Minister's Conference. There, I must leave this topic. And I got to compliment you, Graham Bruce, and you too, Don McMullen, for a good, sane, sensible proposition which could give us jobs in this winter of our miseries.
Jack, if we can get 30 mares up through the forests of North Cowichan with raindrops that are that big and be able to sell them, there's no reason in this world why we can't get you up there on a nice sunny day to show you firsthand what we're talking about and the people of British Columbia how important this is.
Come and see the magic, Jack.
I will. My thanks to Graham
Bruce.
We'll
hold you to that.
And to Don McMullen. Next, Alderman Gordon Campbell of the City of Vancouver, after the break. Alderman Gordon Campbell has been 2.5 months in City Council. He's been making some considerable waves and annoying the otherwise imperturbable Michael Harcourt. And I think that maybe Gordon Campbell, who was a protege, isn't a protege anymore of Art Phillips, may be starting his campaign to have a run at Harcourt's seat. You'd like to be mayor of Vancouver, would you not? Come on.
Someday I might like to be mayor of Vancouver, sure.
And if they need a young NPA candidate to go after what will then be an old doddering Harcourt, you'd like to be the candidate.
In 1986? No.
Not in 1980? No.
Some year.
He's not doddering yet, Michael. No, Michael's not, or is he?
Those are your words, not mine.
But I heard that Michael lost his temper with you with an outburst of sputtering indignation because you dared to criticize the Vancouver Economic Advisory Committee. Please give me a reprieve of how you annoyed Harcourt, which I'd love to have seen, because I can't annoy him.
Well, I think one of the things that happens when you're new and you happen to be the only new member on council is you tend to ask questions about some of the old myths. One of the myths that the mayor has tried to foster is that he's interested in the economic development of the city. And he's done that by creating or being part of endorsing an economic development office, endorsing an economic advisory commission. And he will go and he'll tell us how he's getting rid of business tax, which is a little political subterfuge that he uses. It's a labeling game instead of anything else. And he'll point out that he's got people with six shooters in the out in the hallways instead of the boardroom or whatever. I think that if we're going to have an economic development office, they should be doing things that are substantive, and they should recognize that we have to act. Their acts speak much louder than words, much louder than brochures, and I think that we should get on with acting, I think, in a positive way about economic development.
About this business tax, you apparently were embarrassed by some challenge from Harcourt on the ground that you didn't know that the business tax was being repealed. Who was right in that controversy?
Well, there was a business tax, right? The business tax was a label. When we ended up with the differential mill rate, what happened was we could get rid of the business tax and we could apply that same amount of tax on our property taxes to commercial industrial properties. So effectively this year, the mayor could say, and he would be technically correct, we're removing that name. However, if you look at the statements, we're taking $12.5 million off of the business tax and we're placing it on the business and commercial properties through the property tax.
We haven't got rid of the business tax.
We haven't got rid of any business tax.
We just slapped it on the...
We've changed a name.
And didn't the hotels kick up hell about that?
Well, what happened was when they changed that business tax, there were some significant increases in taxation to hotels, and the hotels did kick up a fuss about it. And over the last 3 years, which have been fairly dismal years for the hotel industry in Vancouver, their taxes have gone up on an average 18%.
So you're saying that Harcourt's much-vaunted Vancouver Economic Advisory Committee is a hoax?
Yes, I'm saying that. Right now, I think that what we've ended up with after 7 years with an economic development office and 7 years with an economic advisory committee is some studies, some recommendations for some brochures, some recommendations for some meetings, and yet council continually does things which in fact give a completely different message to the business community.
Has the Vancouver Economic Advisory Committee ever brought, can claim ever to have brought any business to this city?
I've never heard them claim that.
So it comes up with seminars, promotional studies, reviews, coordinated functions.
Yes.
What was the Superhost program?
Superhost is a program that is devised to try and take care of the people that come for Expo 86. I think that's a positive program. Mm-hmm. I think that if you have an economic development strategy for the 1980s, and we're still working on it in 1985, we're perhaps a little behind time, number one. I think we have to do exactly as Mayor Bruce was just doing. We have to pick an area that we're going to focus our attention. We have scarce resources that we can concentrate on these things and do something properly.
Does it have a budget, this Vancouver Economic Advisory Committee?
The Economic Advisory Commission, I think their budget is something around $15,000. The Economic Development Office has gone from a budget of about $105,000 in 1978 to $271,000 in 1984.
That's a natural bureaucratic pregnancy.
It's a natural, unfortunately, bureaucratic growth, yes. I think that there's a tendency when something isn't working to say, well, let's do twice as much of it.
You mean we spend $278,000 on this Economic Advisory Committee, which really does nothing?
$271,000 on the Economic Development Office.
Oh.
Now, the Economic Development Office was set up in 1978 to do a number of functions. It was one man and an office. They happen to do one thing, I think, quite well, and that is that when a business has a problem, they will help that business through the bureaucracy. They've now come and suggested that because their mandate is expanded, or whatever the terms are that they use, that now they need another one of those people. I don't believe they do need another one of those people. I think we should zero in again and concentrate and focus on some specific activities and do them properly.
How old are you, Gordon?
37.
You were Phillips' executive assistant.
I was Phillips'
executive
assistant.
You look younger than you are, in fact, right?
Yeah, sure.
You do. You look much younger than 37. Hey, we're going to talk about city council, and let's take some calls to the rookie alderman. Get your pet hate about Harcourt off your chest this morning and see if my friend Gordon Campbell will justify it. It's time Harcourt was shaken up a bit. You know, I'm still mad at him. He would never come on the air with me and give me a positive answer as to which side he was on the Owen York thing. I knew he wanted York elected, but he didn't want to say it live on Webster. I'll never forgive him for his fence-sitting and that, although he obviously backed York anyway, and he's got the council he wanted. Have a bash at Harcourt and Gordon Campbell, I should say, after the break. One of my staff was very keen to save the Aurelia building, you know, as a reporter he had a conscience, and I think it should have been bulldozed anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Did you take a position on the Aurelia building?
I wasn't in council when that happened. The Aurelia building was designated a heritage building, I believe, in 74 or 75. And I believe someone came and got it de-designated in 1984, so I wasn't in council at that time.
What's the big thing at council at the moment?
Well, I think there are a number of big issues that are coming up. One of them is obviously the budget that we've got to be concerned about.
It's going to be up 8%?
Well, I think we should keep it to no tax raise in 1985.
Well, of course, the COP are committed not to lay off anybody, even if you don't have a nickel in the bank. Isn't that right?
I think, unfortunately, they're committed to not having any layoffs or letting the management manage, yes.
Well, I think the union spent their $3.50 a head very well to get their man elected.
Well, I think that that's something that people of Vancouver are going to be very concerned about as we go through the next 2 years to make sure that there are no conflicts that evolve. I think there's a conflict of interest in that kind of a development, yeah.
But York would say there'd be a conflict of interest because you get money from real estate developers to bite you. Why shouldn't they get money from unions?
I understand that they say that, and I think that what we should do is we should create a conflict of interest bylaw that will work for both sides, and we set it up before an election, and we run with it.
Not a bad idea. Go ahead, please.
Good morning. You certainly have your nerve to say that Mike Harcourt was a fence sitter. You're one of the biggest fence sitters that ever lived.
Well, that's my business. I'm not running for office. If you don't want to watch me, switch me off.
Don't run other people down then for not taking sides.
Yeah.
Can't take sides? You know perfectly well he can't take sides in an election of that sort.
Don't be stupid. He's a politician.
You're
He's got to take
one.
Sides.
You're the stupid one.
Well, ask me a question and see
if I... Both fence sitters, all you are.
What? Yeah, he won't ask me a question. You think of the bad time, not me. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I wonder if the alderman would care to comment on the Vancouver Centennial Commission. I understand, my understanding is that there has been perhaps $1 million put into this project already, and I have seen very few results.
Well, I think the Centennial Commission is an area that has caused a lot of people a significant amount of concern, including members of council. And council will be having a meeting with the Centennial Commission for a full update next Tuesday on that. I think that from my point of view, you know, they have spent $1 million. There's another two that's basically earmarked for it. And again, it's one of those situations where the new guy comes in and he starts asking questions, and we've got people that are very defensive about it. I think the centennial should be a celebration, and I think everyone in Vancouver should know about it and should be able to participate in it. But I'm not comfortable with the budget that's allocated to them right now.
What have they done with they have $1 million budget?
They have spent approximately $1 million
to
date.
What have they done with it? Is this all on wages for?
It's basically all for wages, yes.
But who heads it?
Their co-chairman, Michael Francis, and the mayor.
Michael Francis?
Yes.
Old, big, skinny Michael Francis.
He's tall, yes.
A tall Michael Francis. That's a politician.
He used to be.
Used to be. Go ahead, please.
Good morning. I think one of the bottom lines with regard to the economy of the city is that they've got a triple A credit rating. And Mr. Campbell, if you think it's a good idea to have some kind of layoffs in the city, I'm just wondering how popular you think that will be with taxpayers who will then be paying these people welfare and UIC, because with a 15% unemployment rate, I doubt they're going to get a job somewhere.
Well, a number of the layoffs that have been suggested, you know, there are numbers of layoffs. People talk about 400 jobs and 500 jobs. In 1982, the management staff of the city did a major review of the budget and staffing and services. There are a number of activities that can take place, including attrition, not filling jobs that have been sitting around and not needed to be filled, looking at some of the things that we maybe implemented in 1967 or 68, which seemed positive, which are no longer required.
So you want service cutbacks, and you want people to start paying extra into UIC and welfare, right?
No, that is not correct. I believe
along with the SOCREDs, right?
Well, the vast majority of tasks that were referred to by the city management staff involve no service cutbacks to the taxpayer.
By the way, what is your official political label? You're a liberal or a social candidate?
I don't have an official political label. I ran for the NPA. Yeah, I don't belong to any other political party.
You don't?
No.
How would you vote in an election?
Depends who is running.
So you vote social credit provincially and Tory nationally?
I vote for the best guy in my riding.
As long as he's not NDP?
No, actually, I voted for Dennis Koch once as well.
Did you?
Yeah.
Good. Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yes.
Yes, I want to say that Mr. Campbell looks like a very bright young man. He keeps up his integrity and he'll go far. That's all I have to say.
Thank you very much. Was that my mother?
Mother. Go ahead, please.
Campbell, I'd like to know your opinion on why the city works department can never get together when they go to do streets and stuff like that. Why is it that they always come in and do the streets and then dig them up to put the gas lines and electrical in?
Well, I wish I could answer that. I'm not sure. The city doesn't put in the gas lines. I know that, but
don't they have a phone where they can phone the different departments and let them know and give them a deadline to have that stuff done?
I think there should be lots more coordination than is going on, I'll tell you that, yes.
You get that question all the time, and it's true, it happens. Go ahead, please.
Oh.
Yeah.
I would like to express my opinion on this Planning Commission, Jack.
Planning Commission?
Yeah.
You mean the Vancouver Economic Advisory Council?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm an old-timer like you are, and I've been around a lot like you have. I've traveled to all kinds of different points, and I got some pretty good ideas. But they're there on Planning Commission, Jack. I don't know if it's not the right guys or of course, not pushing enough or what, but they come up there to a land lease place and their taxes were raised.
Hold on, no, you're not making much sense. I'll tell you what, we haven't raised much of a storm with you this morning. We're kind of quiet now.
What do you want a storm about?
How are we going to pass the next 20 minutes? We'll have a free-for-all, and Alderman Gordon Campbell will hear. And if you want to have it, me or Gordon or whatever, Owen, I've got a phone call coming from somewhere. But anyway, we'll go to a free-for-all after the break. Good morning, and go ahead. What happened here?
Hello?
That's you, sir. Speak up.
Oh, yes. I just wanted to comment about this last thing about giving people on welfare more money. They're going to go to Victoria for it.
Yeah.
Now, I was just wondering, you know, these people are, they're making so much now, but there's so many who don't even want to work in the province now.
I don't like this.
They're not even going to try.
I don't like to say that about people. I've never been in the situation, nor have you, Gordon.
No,
and I don't like to blame people if they do become in a backwater on welfare or whatnot. Who's to say what troubles they've had?
Mr. Campbell ever gone down to a place, or you, Jack, to call the 44 Club on 44 East Cordova?
I haven't been to 44 East.
Yeah, I think I know the place you're talking about.
Okay, the people I see down there, I used to work there, and I go down there because I know the manageress of the place. And these people, there's been people in there for years who just sit there not looking for work. They collect their check.
I think that there are lots of people that I think that's an easy thing. There's 14% unemployment in the city of Vancouver, and I got I just do not believe that there are a lot of people sitting around not looking for work. People want to work, and we have to try and provide them with work. Sure, there, you may find some people, and there may be even 50 in a room, but that's not very many out of the 200 and some odd thousand we have unemployed right now.
It shocks me to see these food banks, doesn't it?
Sure, yeah.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, I'd just like to question Mr. Campbell on the statement that the NPA is apolitical. That's kind of like inferring that the Pope is secretly Lutheran. In my opinion, I think the NPA has sort of demonstrated a political hypocrisy in trying to imply that it is apolitical when it is very political. It's all of its policies have been in support of social credit policies.
Well, that's not true. So, you know, that's just not true.
No,
give me an example of that. The fact of the matter is the NPA is a civic political party. The NPA has got liberals, conservatives, Socreds. I'd be honest, I don't think there are many NDP belonging to the NPA, but the other political parties happen to be...
Social credit in a provincial election. We don't see many liberals voting liberal in the provincial election. And I think that Shaughnessy 2 debacle was a classic example of making political hay out of a fairly logical resolution of a problem. And yet the NPA on city council belabored that thing ad nauseum.
Well, listen, I agree with you to some extent, because the NPA has got to be an anti-socialist coalition to keep the left-wingers out of City Hall. That's basically what you are.
That's what it has been.
That's what it has been. So I'd agree on that. I'd forgotten all about Shaughnessy 2 over $500,000 bit.
Yes.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning. I comment that a lot of our political leaders seem to have reached their place in life by being intellectual. What I'm wondering is, what is this gentleman's work history?
What is your work history?
Sweat.
Sweat, blood, toil, and tears, or something like that.
You're going to lead the people.
It depends how far back you want me to go. I've worked in lumber mills, railroads. I've taught school in Nigeria. I've worked in the mayor's office in Vancouver. I've worked for Marathon Realty. And I've started my own company 3 years ago.
Well, that's encouraging.
Well, no, not too encouraging. You went for Marathon. You should go for him on that one. He was the mayor's executive assistant, Marathon. He's got his own company. What kind of company?
It's called City Core Development.
City Core Development. And he did the usual young Canadian thing in sawmills and logging camps.
I'd like to see our leaders are not getting soft in a position once they reach it. I hope that doesn't happen. Good luck to you.
So do I. Thank you.
What are you shaking your fingers for me? Go ahead from Courtney, please.
I'm from Courtney, and I'd just like to wish everybody in Prince Rupert a happy Valentine's Day, and to you too a happy Valentine's Day, that's all.
Just a minute, how dare you use my program to wish people happy Valentine's?
Well, somebody's phoned in there lots of times on your programs and never ever got the right answer that they wanted to, so I think it's...
Well, I'm not going to say to you, be my love, who's your dolly in Prince Rupert you're trying to communicate on the cheap with? Who is she?
20,000 there.
$20,000. Oh, good for you. And be somebody's Valentine, and I'm glad you added a nice, friendly note to the program this morning. Victoria.
Yes, I'd like to know if your guest would vote for Dennis Koch again.
I can't hear you.
I'd like to know if your guest would vote for Dennis Koch again.
Would you vote for Dennis
Koch
again?
Actually, Dennis isn't in my riding anymore, so I wouldn't vote for him, no.
You wouldn't vote for him? That's a good question. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, seeing how this is a free-for-all, Mr. Webster, I'd like to make a comment on the welfare rates, which are for a single person over the age of 25 is $375 a month.
Right.
So I'm a laid-off management executive in the hotel and hospitality industry, and I have been laid off for the past year and a half. Mm-hmm. With sending out numerous resumes, I've had no luck in obtaining any employment whatsoever, and I've been forced to go on to welfare. Now, I've seen the newspaper that before Christmas, the Honorable Grace McCarthy is unavailable for comment. She's in Palm Springs. After Christmas, the Honorable Grace McCarthy is unavailable for comment. She's vacationing in Hawaii. I'd like to know if perhaps Mrs. McCarthy would like to try living on $375 a month and get the feel of what it's like.
I'm sure she wouldn't want to, and $375 a month barely keeps body and soul together.
My personal rent is $350 a month. That leaves me $25 a month in which to buy my food, put gas in my car, etc., etc. And I am actively seeking employment, And what with the hospitality industry plummeting in BC as it is, there's virtually no work. I can't afford to move. Yet I can't get any extra assistance from the welfare. I can't get any sort of a training program from them. I just wanted to make a point, and I think the whole system stinks.
What's your option? What do you do when you can't pay your rent? Do you get a rent allowance?
Yes, they do.
I get a rental allowance of $200 a month.
That's your $175 plus $200.
Yeah, but my rent is $350, so it leaves me in the cold. I get $25 a month to play with.
Correct. What do you say? I don't know what you say.
Well, I think that you've raised a couple of issues there. One of them that we have requested that they look at a revision of the welfare subsidies that are passed out. But I think equally importantly, we have to get people like you back to work. And in British Columbia, the tourist industry should be the one that we're concentrating on. I think that's where we're going to see the most significant growth over the next 20 years. So
well,
we want to get you back to work.
I appreciate your comments very much, but I see nothing being done. I read the newspapers daily. I see nothing is being done.
And it means you're going to have to downgrade your accommodation from...
It means I might end up living in the Glen Aird Hotel or something like that on Granville Street if things don't get better.
Best of luck. Jasper. Go ahead from Jasper.
Good morning. I'd like to know the Alderman's opinion on the application of the Canadian National Railways and the Canadian Pacific Railways application to run cabooseless trains through Vancouver. Thank you.
Cabooseless train through Vancouver, does that bother you?
Well, it's something that we're looking at right now. We're looking at it with the railroads. We've had our staff look at it. There are some concerns that we have with dangerous goods movement and those sorts of things. I think I would like to see us try and get into that type of technology if we can, but I think that we have to be very careful about public safety as well. So.
In other words, you're tending to go along with the unions that you need the caboose and the railroad cars coming through Vancouver with dangerous cargoes from the point of view of safety?
Yes.
Well, there's an opinion for you. Are you from one of the rail unions?
Yes, I am. I was wondering if the city of Vancouver planned to oppose it in any way.
The city of Vancouver is preparing a position, and they are planning to go to the hearings at least, yes.
They're going to prepare a position, go to the hearings. I didn't know I had regular listeners in Jasper.
All the time.
Well, God bless you. How's the weather?
It's balmy.
Balmy.
Yeah.
Well, get the golf course right, because I'm coming up for a game in June.
Okay, see you then.
Right. After the break. Forgive me, Gordon. I want to show that there are people who send me valentines with a letter like this. Where's the letter? That's the wrong thing. I wanted the letter. Dear Jack, enclosed you will find a portrait of yourself done by my 3.5-year-old daughter. You'll notice she sees you wearing a really big smile all the time, which is more than I can see myself. The two of us watch your show religiously. Kristen has been known to go up to the TV picture tube and kiss you. As a grandfather, I'm sure you'll enjoy this. Thanks for great reporting, great interviewing, and great entertainment. Love, Sylvia Bishop from Delta. And that's from Kristen. And the Valentine hearts are for me and my wife Margaret from Kristen. See? There are people out there who love me. Oh, and I've got another little business to do.
Good.
On the telephone from a ranch 20 miles southeast of Ashcroft, I've got Doreen Harder. And Doreen Harder has a problem caused by the weather. Go ahead, Doreen.
Good morning. We're snowed in here.
How long have you been snowed in on this secondary road close 20 miles from Ashcroft?
This is the fourth day.
You're just going to give me a phrase at a time. This is the fourth day. Have the kids been able to get to school?
No, they haven't.
But how many days have they not been able to get to school?
Today's the fourth day.
How many kids are there all together, and how many of them go to school?
There's 11 kids, and 5 of them go to school.
How many people live in... Does your community have a name?
No, it doesn't have a name. There's 18 of us.
And you've been cut off now for 4 days. Now tell me, how close do the snow plows from Ashcroft come on your road?
8 miles.
So can you not get through with a 4x4 at all?
No, we've got drifts of snow. snow 3 and 4 feet high.
What are you going to, what does the highways department tell you?
That there's nothing they can do for us.
So you might be snowed up for the rest of the year.
That's right.
Do you not have any vehicles of your own with a plow on them that can go through?
We've got a D2 and a D4, and they're just not, they're an old vintage, and they just can't make it through the deep snow.
Have you spoken to the highways people at Lillooet?
Yes, I have. I've even talked to the office in Victoria, and I spoke to Mr. Carr, and he said that there's nothing that they can do for us.
They don't give a dash if you're cut off between now and the 1st of April.
That's about it.
And why? Have they got no money?
That's what they said, that, you know, there's just no way that they can do anything for us. They never really gave us any definite reason. It's just the same answer every time I call them.
Did they plow your road last big snowfall?
They hired someone to come in with a cat to do about 4 miles of it for us, and we did the rest ourselves with our cat.
But your cat's no good this year, and you're stuck, and Mr. Carr, whoever he is in Victoria, says no money to plow you out to civilization.
Right.
Will you hold on, my dear? Don't go away. I think someone else here may be interested in your problem. And Alex Fraser, it doesn't seem right. If this is a secondary road, surely you can borrow a couple of bucks from the bank and plow that road through to these 20 people. There may be some emergency. Take it away, what's your name again, Wyatt? You got it? I don't want to hang up on him. See, we do all kinds of things with all kinds of people.
Excellent work.
No more calls. Gordon, thanks very much for being here this morning.
Thank you, Jack. I appreciate it.
And I trust somebody's got to stand up to Harcourt, you know?
Well,
I like him very much indeed, if he would ever make up his mind which day of the week it is.
Well, I've known Mike for 12 years, and I like him a lot, too. Doesn't mean I like everything he stands for or he does, but I do like him.
He's a courteous, pleasant gentleman.
I wish him a happy Valentine's Day as well.
Happy Valentine's Day, Mike, from both Webster and from Gordon Campbell. And I shall return after the break. Kaplan, the liberal critic of Mulroney, will be here tomorrow morning. And something else is here this morning. There are people who love me. This is a beautiful Valentine for me. It's either from or to a charming girl I work with called Maureen Richardson. Thank you very much, Maureen. Happy Valentine to every little person out there. And I'll be back tomorrow, nagging again at 9 a.m. precisely. Half a million new jobs for Canadians? Watch Webster on Check at midnight.